Hachette Audio presents John Marshall, The Man Who Made the Supreme Court. Written by Richard Brookhiser. Read by Robert Fass. To Lewis E. Lehrman. Introduction. John Marshall and George Washington. John Marshall is the greatest judge in American history. As Chief Justice of the Supreme Court for 34 years, a record that still stands, he impressed, charmed, and defied colleagues, skeptics, and enemies, transforming an institution to which the founding fathers had given relatively little thought into a pillar of the nation. In 1801, when Marshall became Chief Justice, the job lacked dignity, as one contemporary put it, while the judiciary was, in the words of another, the weakest branch of the federal government. When Marshall died in 1835, he and the court he led had rebuked two presidents, Congress, and a dozen states, and laid down principles of law and politics that still apply. Now, when the Supreme Court makes the news every day it sits, and every time a new justice must be appointed, there is no question of its prominence, a prominence it owes in the first instance to Marshall, the man who made it. But the most formative experiences of Marshall's life came not in court, but in battle. That was where he met George Washington, the man he called simply the greatest man on earth, whose example would inspire and guide him for the rest of his life. In September 1777, the Continental Army, led by Commander-in-Chief George Washington, met a British army led by Lord Howe at Brandywine Creek in Pennsylvania, 30 miles southwest of Philadelphia, the new nation's capital. Washington lost the Battle of Brandywine, and the British took the city. In October, he counterattacked at Germantown, a hamlet north of Philadelphia, but once again, he was defeated. Before the year ended, Washington faced a third fight. His troops were dug in behind a line of redoubts at White Marsh, northwest of the city. In early December, Howe and his men marched out of Philadelphia toward them. Washington was threatened by more than the enemy. Congress, dismayed by the loss of the capital, demanded that he strike the enemy and recover it. John Marshall was in Washington's army that winter, a lieutenant in a Virginia regiment. He was tall, strong, and slovenly, with black hair and bright black eyes. He had recently turned 22 and was already a two-year veteran who had fought in four engagements. Decades later, in a biography of George Washington, the only book he ever wrote, he recalled his commander's predicament at White Marsh. Washington knew his troops were in no shape to launch another attack. They had fought two battles in 2 months and lacked shoes, uniforms, and weapons. Washington, wrote Marshall, had too much discernment and too much firmness of temper to be distracted by the torrent of public opinion, the clamors of faction, or the discontents of ignorance. Yet if the enemy attacked, he must be ready to meet them. So the American chief rode through every brigade of his army, delivering in person his orders respecting the manner of receiving the enemy, exhorting his troops to rely principally on the bayonet, and encouraging them by the steady firmness of his countenance, as well as by his words, to a vigorous performance of their duty. The author states this on his own observation, Marshall added, proudly, I was there, self-effacingly, he put it in a footnote. After 2 days of skirmishing, the British withdrew. Washington would not be lured from his prepared positions, and Howe decided it would be too risky to assault them. Marshall explained the enemy's retreat thus. Howe's return to Philadelphia without bringing on an action, after marching out with the avowed intention of fighting, is the best testimony of the respect which he felt for the talents of his adversary and the courage of the troops he was to encounter. Washington's talents, soldiers' courage, Marshall would never forget them. The Revolutionary Army drew patriotic young men from every state who risked privation, injury, and death for their common country. The man who commanded them struck where he could and stood firm when he had to. He was judicious, brave, and a leader of men. For the rest of his life, John Marshall saw Washington as his commander and himself as one of his troops. In 1787, Washington left his post-war retirement to preside over the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. Marshall, still in his early 30s, was not yet eminent enough to be sent as a delegate to that meeting, but in 1788, he served in the Virginia Ratifying Convention in Richmond, defending the Constitution that Washington had signed. In 1798, Washington summoned his former junior officer to Mount Vernon and told him to run for Congress. Marshall obeyed. In 1799, after the great man died, it was Marshall who eulogized him on the floor of the House as first in war, first in peace, and first in the hearts of his countrymen. But Washington was more than a hero to Marshall. He was a man with principles and an agenda, who had learned from the privations of his army the need for a capable national government, and who then worked as a constitution maker and president to design and lead one. How could Marshall support Washington while he lived and defend his handiwork after he was gone? The most obvious way was politics, and Marshall had an abiding interest in it. In the first national two-party system that emerged in the 1790s, the party Marshall joined was the Federalists. Their policies were Washington's: a strong federal government that could pay its debts, foster commerce, and sustain a unified nation in a turbulent world. Marshall was friendly with every prominent Federalist: Washington, John Adams, Alexander Hamilton, Timothy Pickering, even when, as their party began to sink at the turn of the century, they turned on each other. The only man Marshall ever hated was Federalism's enemy and destroyer, and his own cousin, Thomas Jefferson. Federalism withered and died, new parties emerged. Marshall kept tabs on them all. He was touted as a presidential candidate himself in one election season, and in another, he attended America's first national political convention, organized by America's first third party. The Marshall campaign went nowhere, as did the third party. Yet although politics was a lifelong interest of Marshall's, it was not his main one. He had a vocation, which was the law. His father Thomas had decided that his eldest child should be a lawyer. William Blackstone's Commentaries on the Laws of England, then the most popular legal text in the English-speaking world, was part of John's homeschooling. In 1780, while on a furlough from the army, he attended a course of lectures in the law at William and Mary, the only formal legal instruction he would ever receive. But since the course was given by George Wythe, one of the top legal minds in the country, it was first rate. After the war, Marshall established a practice in Richmond, Virginia's new capital, quickly joining the state's legal elite. His practice was so engrossing that he refused several offers of national public office. In 1801, however, after serving in Congress and as Secretary of State, he agreed to become the nation's Chief Justice. The Supreme Court that Marshall led was the federal government's fledgling, almost its orphan. In 12 years, it had traveled with the nation's capital through three cities: New York, Philadelphia, and the brand new site on the Potomac. Between terms, justices were required to ride circuit over hundreds of miles of woeful roads. Partly because of these hardships, three men had already cycled through the post of Chief Justice before Marshall took the job. The law that the court administered was in no better shape. Americans were already famously litigious, but the legal arena in which they struggled was poorly marked. Colonial precedents had been upset by the Revolution. Many Americans, from pioneers on the margins of settlement to wealthy grandees, simply broke whatever laws there were, old or new. Americans went to court to scramble for land and to exploit new technology, to defend their religious and political beliefs, and to attack the beliefs of their neighbors. Black men and red men went to court, mostly, though not always, unsuccessfully, for relief from injustices committed by white men went to court to gouge each other. At the helm of the Supreme Court, Marshall brought order to this chaos. He did it by expressing and implementing the principles he had imbibed from Washington and from other Federalists such as Alexander Hamilton.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.